plant-predominant diets may play a major role in reversing the obesity and chronic disease epidemics, just as plant-based dietary interventions may arrest or even reverse type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease on an individual basis. In a previous video, I showed how a tofu burger boosted levels of the appetite-suppressing hormone GLP-1 higher than a meat burger in both people with diabetes and without, even though the two burgers were matched for calories and macronutrients. One thing may have given the plant-based meal an edge, though, at least over time: increased fiber. The bacterial fermentation of dietary fibers in the colon produces short-chain fatty acids called acetate, propionate, and butyrate, which in turn stimulate release of GLP-1. In this way, prebiotics like dietary fiber represent an alternative strategy for boosting production of GLP-1. In contrast, a bacterial breakdown product of tryptophan, which is concentrated in animal protein, has been found to have opposite effects on GLP-1 release. How do we know fiber-derived short-chain fatty acids boost GLP-1 in the first place? Well, all three circulating short-chain fatty acids were associated with higher GLP-1 concentrations in the blood, but that doesn't prove cause and effect. For that, you need to stick tubes in people's butts. Getting a rectal infusion of acetate indeed causes GLP-1 levels to go up, and the amount of acetate concentrations in the blood reached after rectal infusion were within an achievable range, in the ballpark of what you get eating 15 or more grams of fiber a day here in the form of oat bran cereal and muffins. There's a third way to get appetite-suppressing short-chain fatty acids in our bloodstream, besides the top-down approach of eating healthy food and the bottoms-up approach of getting them squirted in your tush. When you consume vinegar, its acetic acid is rapidly neutralized into acetate. Here's the spike in acetate in your bloodstream that you get from consuming about a tablespoon of vinegar mixed in water. No wonder vinegar has evidently been used to treat obesity for centuries. Does this all translate into reducing cravings, eating less, and losing weight? Let's scan people's brains and find out. Researchers delivered propionate, fiber-derived short-chain fatty acid, into the colons of study participants while showing them images of pizza, cakes, and chocolates, and found that increasing colonic propionate seemed to reduce brain activation in the reward centers of the brain. This was accompanied by a decrease in subjective appeal of these kinds of foods. They didn't look as tasty, and this translated into reduced caloric intake at a buffet meal. Note that this effect didn't seem to correlate with GLP-1 changes, though, so it's possible that short-chain fatty acids produced in the colon are accessing the brain directly and reducing appetite some other way. Regardless, does the boost in GLP-1 and the short-term reduction of caloric intake from the direct delivery of propionate to the colon translate into better weight control in overweight adults? Yes. Long-term colonic propionate delivery prevents body weight gain, particularly deep abdominal fat, and may even reduce liver fat in those with fatty liver disease. So you'd expect prebiotic trials to show the same, and sometimes they worked, boosting GLP-1 and driving down hunger. But overall, human interventions with prebiotics have shown mixed results, and that's putting it lightly. Effects on GLP-1 appear to be highly contradictory, with different isolated dietary fibers bumping GLP-1 up, some dropping it down, and others having no effect. In some cases, it's possible that macronutrients that would otherwise stimulate GLP-1 might get caught up in viscous fibrous masses and result in lower levels. Regardless, results for short-term prebiotic trials are said to be completely inconclusive for GLP-1. Well, one problem may be the dose. For example, in this study, researchers tested refined grain bread versus whole grain bread. Although the whole grain bread improved satiety, it had no effect on GLP-1. The difference in fiber content was only about 5 grams, though, which may not be enough. In this study, study participants were randomized to get either 5 or 10 grams of a fiber supplement called Fibersol, and the 5-gram dose appeared to have no greater effect on GLP-1 than placebo. Only the 10-gram dose worked, which is about 2 tablespoons. Similarly, there were significant delays in hunger and increased satiety after 10 grams, but not 5. And studies like this may only last a few hours. The more fiber-rich foods you eat, the more you foster the growth of more fiber feeders, which means even more GLP-1 secretion over time. Eating more fiber-rich foods may eventually even promote the emergence of more GLP-1 secreting cells in our intestinal lining. Check out this study. adaptation of colonic fermentation and GLP-1 secretion with increased fiber intake for not a few hours, but an entire year. People who eat whole grains tend to get less diabetes, but even if you switch to whole wheat for weeks or months, there doesn't seem to be much improvement in blood sugar control. It turns out it may take longer than that for our colon to adapt to the increased fiber intake. Colonic adaptation to increased wheat fiber intake takes many months, but eventually results in increased short fatty acid production and GLP-1 secretion. This was found when people were randomized to a year of either All Bran or Rice Krispies cereal for breakfast, and there was a significant increase in short-chain fatty acid production and GLP-1 secretion in the higher fiber group, but it took 9 to 12 months for these benefits to develop. And finally, people may not understand the complexity of dietary fiber, thinking that it's a single nutrient, but there are literally thousands of types of fiber in plant foods, and each one may support different communities of bacteria in our gut. That's the reasoning behind recommendations that people take a 50-food challenge, eating at least 50 different plant foods a week to achieve a diet diverse enough to feed a vast spectrum of bacteria. Those who get more fiber in their diet are significantly less likely to get heart disease and die from heart disease, less likely to get cardiovascular disease in general and less likely to die from it, less likely to have a stroke, less likely to get diabetes and colorectal cancer, less likely to die from cancer across the board, and less likely to die from all causes put together. But all this is for fiber from food. In terms of fiber intake for optimal health, the first line of defense for disease prevention is to focus on fiber from foods rather than supplements. For the treatment of disease, there's a lack of evidence-based research to support the use of most isolated fiber types. Take that supplement Fibersol, for example. Fibersol is a registered trademark of the Matsutani Chemical Industry Company, the one who invented it. Looking to increase the fiber content of a finished product? Check out our innovation success stories. Eat your donut cookie whipped cream milkshake. It's got fiber. Maybe better to stick to foods that were invented instead by Mother Nature.